Hello, I'm Cara Williams. All over the world, I play pipe organs for a living.
I love it.
I meet great concert organists.
Now, as I meet them, I'd like you to meet them too.
Here's the bench,
and here's me.
There's not always a bench. That's a metaphor.
Here we go.
That's stupid. This is kind of fun.
This is wonderful. I didn't even know what to do. Did I know we were doing this? That's great.
No, we didn't. So, I mean...
I love it.
You like the organ very much, huh?
I do. I think it's a very... You know, it's not a organ you say, well, this is a Bach organ or this is a Vidor organ or anything. But as a general organ, I think it has a lot of class. And the Big 32 is close to the one at Notre Dame.
Yeah, that's...
That's really the biggest 32 I ever heard in my life.
Yeah?
And that's my favorite organ, I think. Although last time I was there, I asked somebody, I said, well, I came to hear the organ recital in the afternoon. And she said, oh, the organ isn't playing. So then I found out from somebody that it, you know, it was rebuilt by, I think, someone in Holland.
I can't.
And the electronics don't.
Yes, I remember that issue in the papers. Right. That made world news, didn't it?
See, would that make world news in America? No.
I don't know.
It's like playing in a swell box.
Yeah.
It's too clear and it's too like this.
It's like looking in the mirror first thing in the morning.
That's right. And seeing
this wrinkle here. Now we're going to make it better.
Yeah. It's a very exposed instrument.
So you say it's changed over the years, the organ?
Well, it doesn't even sound like the organ I play.
Can you remember what it's, I mean...
Yes, it had no mixtures and it had no... The reeds sounded like Wurlitzer reeds and was dull and out of tune. And it was like playing a big calliope.
Do you remember what you played?
Well, I'm sure it was a lot of boxes. I'm a box specialist. I'm a high priest.
A high priest. You know, Wynton Marsalis gave you that name, mm-hmm. High priest.
Yeah.
I mean, why?
Okay, there's a story.
Yeah.
I have so many stories.
Yeah.
All right. I was the conductor for the English Chamber Orchestra, but you must know all the players. And we recorded the Gabriel's Garden album in 1997. And that album was the largest selling classical CD. CD? Was it a CD? Yes. Mm. Ever. Yeah. I mean, in that year. So... Wynton invited me to play and show how you improvise in particular styles. Of course, he's a great jazz player. And at Lincoln Center, was it Alice Tully Hall, I think, or the Big Hall? And so I improvised in Bach style, and then a little bit in more modern style. And then we played a Bach piece together, and we both improvised. And then he said, I want you to know that Anthony was playing, and he's the high priest, the very high priest of Bach. So I took that title.
Yeah.
Because it sells.
Yeah.
You don't want to believe your publicity, but it sells.
Well, yeah, say what you like. Yeah, yeah. Spell the name, right?
And I have a good one from Time magazine also, for the harpsichord, the high priest of the harpsichord.
So what? I mean, I'm in awe sitting on the...
Oh, don't be...
Sitting on the
I'm
couch.
I'm in awe sitting with
no,
you.
I mean,
I'm
a
Buddhist.
I
have a Buddhist... I'm a Buddhist kind of person, so... Yeah.
I was so upset you couldn't come last year. I mean, we had fans...
Not as upset as I
was. No, I know, but a lot of people were really upset, but we're really delighted you're going
to
play
it's
tonight.
It's such a pleasure to do this, and I'm trying to play, as I get older, the program for memory. I've played these pieces so many times. And the music that most gives me anxiety for memory is to play my own music, as if anybody would even know whether I'm playing anything
really
right or not. Yeah, it's the music, the big fugue in D, which is a pedal fugue, is very difficult. And I think, oh my God, I have to remember this. So anyway, it's interesting. You know, most concert organists, is that right? Half of them play for memory. Most people don't. Some people do.
I don't care.
It doesn't matter to me.
I mean, you don't listen with your eyes.
Of course, I never listen with my eyes.
You listen to a CD.
I close my eyes and just
Yeah.
Listen, so.
I mean, I have scores there. I don't read it.
Yes. No, it's like a...
It's like, it's kind of nice to have it there.
A memory aid that you yeah, sort of, you
especially
know.
For registration.
Absolutely. Yeah. That's the problem with the organ.
So why, you know, when you were really young, you started playing the organ.
When I could reach the pedals.
When you, yeah.
I was 10.
Why Bach? I mean...
Well, when I was five, my parents liked classical music. My mother adored it. Mm. She played the piano as an amateur. And when I first started listening to great music, I was about five. I remember hearing, you know, Mozart symphonies and Bach, Brandenburgs. And the Bach music gave me to such elation that I would, you know, weep or cry out. Ah! Like that as a kid. And so I wanted to play Bach's music. And so I could play not very well when I was seven or eight, some of the big fugues from the Well-Tempered. Mm-hmm. But I could read music before I could read words.
So could I.
Is that right?
I was sent to dance classes when I was about four and a half.
Is that right?
I just refused to do ballet. Uh-huh. And I stood by the piano.
Well, you look like a ballerina.
And I just got, I was hooked to the piano. And now my parents bought a really cheap piano because they weren't sure if this
sure,
was a whim.
But of course.
They were worried that I could play my piece.
Yeah.
But I didn't know what the piece.
Sure.
I didn't know which one it was.
Well, we both had a similar childhood then with music. I mean, yeah. Music became obsessive for me where I really didn't want to do anything else.
Yeah.
And we had a little piano. Wasn't very good. And that's all that I did. And then I knew that music was going to be my... Everybody in the family was a lawyer, and yeah. I just wasn't interested in that. So,
Did your family try and put off, you know, you doing music as a profession?
No, because I seemed so avid
yeah.
for it that it looked inevitable. And it's... what did I do? Then I went to Paris when I was 18 and got a degree from, do you know the École Normale de Musique?
I know all of yeah. it. Really.
Well, the head of that time was Alfred Cortot. Oh,
here's great another, pianist.
I have another story. Do we have time for another story? I was 18. I had two majors there, one in piano, one in harpsichord.
Wow.
And then I had a third major in organ with Pierre. So I spent my entire thing, you know, running around to find instruments to practice on. Mm. I was very poor. And my French piano teacher got me a French government scholarship, which at that time paid like $60 a month, which made the difference between eating or not, really. And there was an old man who walked around the school with a cane and would pick up trash and any things. And I said, it's very nice that somebody is doing that, but he's so old. So when I went to play my exam, I walked out on the thing. It's public exam. It's much more than just an exam here. It's like a concert.
A concert.
And sitting on this fancy seat at the top was the same old man. And so I said to my teacher, I said, qui est-il? She said, ah, c'est Alfred Cordon, n'est-ce pas? So I just didn't recognize him. Yeah. And I thought he was the janitor. Picking up all the trash. So
I'm embarrassed.
That's a story I tell all the time.
When did you study with Kosherov?
When I was same, all this was the same time, 18 years old, 18 to 19, and then I played at the cathedral. You're supposed to play a pre-service recital on a Sunday, like the second Sunday of May. And I have another story.
But I've got to ask you before we go there. Did you know
how
famous Kosherov was when you went to study with him, or was he just a name? I mean,
No, I knew because I had heard him play in this country, and I knew all about him and his.
So, what was it like when you first sat down to play with the master?
I had a great time with him. I loved him. He, first of all, what we call performance practice, all that stuff, didn't start until about 1960. Yeah. That's when it all got going. It really went in London and in Amsterdam. That's where all of this, and even to this day, you really can't play Bach or Handel in London or Amsterdam on anything except period instruments without getting, ridiculous. So I knew he was. I heard him improvise, and I thought his Bach playing sounded like most of European Bach playing. But... I love the way he just used his spirit because my organ teacher knew him very well. Mm-hmm. So I went to Paris and when I first played for him, I, of course, played Bach and Franck, the standard, you know, the repertoire. And he said about the Bach, and even at that time I played it all much more separated and much faster and rhythmically and all of that. So he said, well, he said, nobody, and he spoke very good English, and my French was very poor at this time. So he said, nobody in Europe plays it that way, but I can see how from that period that you would play it that way, and I'm not against that.
Yeah.
So I don't think anybody else in Paris would have said that, because everything is much more, you know.
Strict. So when you, did you have lessons at Notre Dame?
No, that's the other story. He, because he was wealthy, with his wife bought a five-story house in the center of Paris with an elevator on the fifth floor.
Gosh.
On the fifth floor. He built a similar organ to Notre Dame with five keyboards and at least 100 stops on the fifth floor.
Yeah.
And that's where I would go.
Did he let you rehearse in the cathedral?
Oh, that's the other story. I went up there. This is the first time I played the organ. You know, it's huge. It's the old, huge
that
organ.
That would have been the old console.
So I said, well, he said, I don't even know the organ. Can I play a little bit? No, no, you can't play.
Oh.
So I said, yeah, can I play before I have to actually play the concert? He said, no, unfortunately, it's not possible. So I said, well, will you register for me? Because I don't even, the organ had 110 stops. And, you know, it's all fanned out and the, there was dust all over the organ too. That's the other thing. So I said, well, I'm going to play, so I'll start. And he said, all right, you can start now. Then I went to play and he said, oh, no, you have to play all the Bach an octave higher because there's no mixtures on the organ. This is before the, so of course the organ only goes up to G.
Yeah.
So I said, well, what do I do when I run out of notes? He said, oh, then you jump back down. So that was the story of my playing at Notre Dame. It was one of the thrilling moments of my life anyway. I mean, the organ had 53 reeds. It's all like, you know, just a tremendous racket.
Concerts are well attended now. Were
unbelievably. I went to hear one.
Yeah.
It was full. It was 2,300 people or something like that. In fact, I went in and the guy said, are you here for the mass or for the concert? And the concert to get in was $28. So I said, oh, I'm here to hear the mass.
High priest, or I'm on to your high priest.
So I got in for free. So, but there's still, and if you go into Notre Dame on the left, there's a little place where they still sell his recordings.
Yeah.
And I dedicated a piece to him once, but it was a great experience.
So talking about composition, you have composed a huge amount.
Yeah, I have actually just put out a 20 CD set of my oeuvre complète.
How do you do it? I mean, are you systematic about how you compose every day, or do you wait for an inspiration? How does it work for you?
I've decided now, as I think several composers in America decided, that I've written enough music, so I don't write any more music. I have such a huge. I have 5 symphonies and 5 concertos and 2 operas, and I mean, unless somebody asks for a piece.
Yes.
And commissions a piece, I don't write anymore. And I wrote enough organ music. I mean, it's more than César Franck wrote for the organ, so but it's hard to play, and I have now arranged it for piano 4 hands, which it sounds what it's very effective, and people can actually play it.
So when you were doing lots of composition, how did you divide up your own rehearsing of your own, you know, playing whatever you're playing for a concert and composing? How did you set about doing that?
Well, I was mainly a composer when I was at Harvard. I was in the middle of all the crazy stuff. I was the teaching assistant of Luciano Berio when he was there. And so I was involved with the avant-garde at the time. And I did write a few pieces at that time, which I hide now in the closet. Of that style, you know, the ultra 12 tone, 14 tone, and 15 tone.
Not good for here on a Monday night.
Oh, I don't think it's good for anything.
I would get them out quickly.
Yeah, they immediately rose, not to give you a standing ovation, but to quickly run out the door. I was involved in all of that, and then when I thought at the end of it all that I would no one would ever like this music, and I didn't like it, and I thought it was just a terrible mistake. Yeah. And I said that publicly a couple of times, and it got me into a lot of trouble. So I stopped writing for 30 years. I figured, well, someone has to, you know, change this. Mm. So that's the Goretzky Third Symphony. That changed everything. It was tonal and pretty and had melodies. And I thought, well, if he had a huge success with it. He sold 200,000 CDs.
Whoa.
It's staggering.
Yes.
He was also fired from the Polish Conservatory for writing such, how did they describe it, music that was not current.
Gosh.
Ridiculous. As if someone has a right to say this is current or not.
What, I know. Who knows?
It's either fine music or it's not.
Yes.
So that started me writing again, and then I wrote all my music between 1985 and the present. And I stopped. The last piece I wrote was the big piece on Stravinsky's Oedipus Rex. I'm a big Stravinsky fan. Mm. And in fact, it was just...
It's a shame he didn't like the organ.
Oh! He said about the organ, it doesn't breathe. Of course, it's the organists who don't breathe.
Absolutely,
you know,
right.
It's just, you know...
Absolutely right.
He has a few bars in Canticum Sacrum that are actually...
Yeah, that's all, I remember,
you know,
that,
they
yeah.
wrote, you know, so.
When you... A normal day for you, getting down to the nitty-gritty, mm-hmm. when you're back home and... Mm-hmm.
What do I do?
Yeah, what do you... How do you rehearse every day?
I do. I practice every day. Not very much. Yeah. I used to practice a lot.
When you talk a lot, how much is a lot?
Couple of hours.
Yeah.
Couple
so
of
how
hours.
Much do you do now?
Oh, no. A couple, a lot is 5 hours. Yeah. I used to do 5 hours. Now I do 2 hours, and mm-hmm. I'm a meditator. I meditate 2 or 3 hours.
Do you really?
Yeah, I do.
Uh-huh. Does that obviously helps, what, focusing? Do you do that before a concert?
I do.
Yeah.
I'm a big meditator and sort of a Zen student, but I combine it with Christianity, too. It's a lot of people do this.
Yeah.
And then what else do I do?
You obviously keep fit.
I'm a runner.
You're a runner?
Yeah. I'm a regular runner. And what else do I do?
Is that the hobby or do you have a hobby? What do you do to switch off? I mean, I go
to movies.
I like horse riding.
Oh.
And I find just something the complete opposite.
It's just, yeah, that's very interesting.
It just re-nourishes.
Well, that's what I do at movies. My brain doesn't have to function.
Yeah.
It's very helpful, actually. And then my wife and I often, we go to the beach.
Yeah.
I love the beach. And we have a small beach, but nothing like here.
No.
You know, this is completely fantastic.
Yeah.
And so then we have 3 children. The youngest is getting married in August 2nd.
Oh, that's nice. Congrats. So. Are they musical?
The youngest one and the middle one are musical, but they're not in music.
Did you teach them music, or was that a no-no? I mean, was it hard, you know, relationship-wise to teach your kids?
The little one, who is now 42, was very receptive to music and also to meditation. And the middle one, Matthew, played the guitar, and he had a rock band.
Yeah.
Everybody's kids now have rock bands who are musical. And it's a good thing, you know, what a problem it is to make a living in music. So classical music is a terrible problem. So you spend all your childhood and all your energy into it, and then you get, what do you get at the end of that? You know,
I think you don't.
Pour coffee at Starbucks.
You know what, I think you, I like to compose.
Oh, you do?
Not
I didn't know
way
that.
As much as you, but yeah. I lose myself, and I'm not looking at the clock. I think that's what I get when I, my career. I'm not looking to retirement. I mean, what am I going to do when I retire?
You can't retire if you're in classical music. You'll drop dead. You'll jump out a window.
I wouldn't want it.
Oh, of course, because all the joy comes from all that. What are you going to do? Stop it?
That's what I think. It is huge job satisfaction.
Incredible.
We get a lot of young students coming to the concerts here on Monday nights.
Oh, you do?
And it really is quite an area for organ students. What would be your advice to somebody starting out, who wants to make a career
needless to say, you can make a career in playing in churches.
Yes.
You can
but
make a living.
If they hell bent on going, no, I want to be a concert organist. I want to be like you. I mean, what would you say?
Well, I would explore the few worldwide venues that there are for the organ. And try and get some kind of sponsorship to apply and actually go and play on a series that has reputation. There are very few, very few. And to try and get a review is, for example, if you're trying to get a review in the Oregon from the New York Times, you know how difficult that is?
I can believe it.
I mean, when I was in my heyday, so to speak, I have like 5 reviews from the Times. But now, were I to play in New York someplace, I'd never get a review. It's the last review that I got was 2004 at St. Bart's in New York. It's just very hard to suggest, besides playing in a church, making your own series and also making it entertaining. I'm not, what's the term? Ambitious. I'm not. I'm not an ambitious.
You've done very well for not being ambitious.
Well, it's my agents. They have done all of this. I haven't done this. I've just cooperated.
You've got an immense ability, and you've got such a tremendous following out there.
Well, you're very kind. Thank you.
You know, Anthony Newman, it's been a pleasure chatting.
It's been a pleasure chatting with you, too.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Good.
That was fun.
Yeah, we got a lot of stories. Yeah.